Hello everybody, I am Zach Peterson. Welcome back to my channel. Today we are going to be looking at a viewer question that is a follow-up to one of my videos on Altium Academy, all about whether or not differential pairs need a ground plane. Now, if you're designing a printed circuit board with controlled impedance interfaces, then frankly, yes, your PCB does need a ground plane to support those differential pairs. But what else can you do around those differential pairs on, for example, a two-layer board? And with that in mind, how do they define impedance on a two-layer board, even if that two-layer board does not have a dedicated ground plane? That's what we're going to look at in this video, and we're going to look at one of the example projects that I've shown on Altium Academy and that I have available for download on my company website. Let's go ahead and hop in and get started. Now, before we jump into Altium, let's take a look at that viewer question about ground around differential pairs. This question came from our "Do you really need ground for differential pairs?" video on Altium Academy. And you can see here, I received a question from XR17992, and it's actually three different questions. So we're gonna run through each of these questions, and we're gonna look at the answer in one of our example projects that's available on my company website. So XR writes, "Many thanks for the video. Everything is clear, but I also would like to know the answer to the following questions. Number one, for example, I use a two-layer PCB without ground under a differential pair. Can I route signals on the opposite side? Number two, in the previous case, should I place ground traces or polygons around the differential traces? Number three, for example, if I have a ground plane under a differential trace and then the plane ends, but the differential traces keep going further, and from some point there is no ground plane under it anymore, that's clearly not a good thing, but how bad is it really?" So to help answer these questions, let's take a look at our USB to UART converter bridge module that I have presented on Altium Academy and which is available for download from my company website. So if you want to get access to the files for the project that you see here on screen, check out the link in the description. That will take you to a project page, which gives you a little overview of this project, and then you can get access to the files through Altium 365. So first things first, let me just go through and shelve all of the polygons here in this design so we can just take a look at the traces. Now in this design, we do have a lot of space open on the back layer, and as you can see, I only put the VDD line on the back layer, but I certainly could have routed some traces along the back layer. So just because you didn't have the ground plane beneath the differential pair on the back layer doesn't mean that you couldn't put some traces along the back layer. You absolutely could put some traces on this bottom layer. Now, if I'm routing a trace on this back layer, and if I route it close to this differential pair, there is a risk that the high-speed signal being carried by my differential pair creates crosstalk into this signal on the bottom layer. So this is, again, all about crosstalk. You just want to make sure that you don't get that other signal too close to your differential pair, and then there's not going to be a danger of crosstalk. Just move it out of the way and make sure that it doesn't have a chance to interact with the differential signal on that differential line. So how far away does it need to be? Well, it really depends, right? It depends on the dielectric constant of your substrate. It depends on how far away the ground is from those traces. It depends on how wide the traces are, and it depends on the edge rate of the aggressor signal on that differential pair. Now, the single-ended trace could also inject noise onto the differential pair, which could then be seen as a combination of differential mode noise and common mode noise. Normally, if we receive crosstalk onto a differential pair, we would like it to be as common mode, because differential receivers will suppress common mode noise. Unfortunately, if it's received as differential mode noise, it will then take up some of the noise margin in that receiver interface. This is something we would normally confirm with simulation, but if you don't have a simulator available, you can always just use the 3W rule of thumb. In a lot of situations, the 3W rule is overly conservative, but hey, you're dealing with two-layer boards with a lot of space on the back layer, so just enforce a 3W clearance between your differential pair on the top layer and whatever signals you have on the bottom layer. Let's look at the next part of that question. In the previous case, should I place ground traces or polygons around the differential trace? Well, the first thing I'll tell you is don't use ground traces. There's really no point in using ground traces unless you are working in audio for frequency ranges. But if you're working with digital data, then just use coplanar ground. So here, if I just restore my shelved polygons and re-pour everything, you can see here on the top layer what that coplanar ground looks like. The coplanar ground just comes right up to the edge of this differential pair, and we have our clearance rule set up in our design rules to enforce the distance between the edge of each of these traces and the coplanar copper ground. If we're dealing with digital data, why do we need that coplanar ground? Well, the coplanar ground is important for defining the impedance of that differential pair, and it's needed to define the impedance of the differential pair. Otherwise, the traces in this differential pair are going to be huge. So just as an example, let's take this stack up, and let's take this stack up all the way out to being an egregiously large 1,000 mils thick. Now, the reason I'm doing that is to move the ground plane on layer 2 very far away from the differential pair. Now, you can see here that when we have the differential pair with coplanar ground on the same layer, you can see that the coplanar ground is sufficient to define the impedance of our differential pair at 90 ohms, which is exactly what we want for USB. So now let's look at another differential impedance calculation, but without the coplanar ground. Here, if we have a differential impedance calculation, again at 90 ohms, and we set a small trace gap of 5 mils, you can see here that the width is 50% larger for that trace in that differential pair. Now, if we start to make this trace gap a little bit larger, you can see here that if we just make the trace gap 10 mils, which is not that much larger, you can see now that the width of this differential pair increases to 35 mils for each trace. Now, that's already an impractical value. That's not going to be something that you're able to use on most connectors or integrated circuits. So you need to have that coplanar ground and tight coupling in order to keep the trace width small enough that you can actually route into connectors and route into the pins on integrated circuits. So now let's look at that third and final question. Number 3, for example, I have a ground plane under a differential trace and then the plane ends, but the differential trace keeps going and there's no ground plane under it anymore. How bad is this? So first, let me draw out on screen the situation that he's describing. That would basically be like taking this polygon and pulling it back right here, and then going over to the bottom layer, also pulling back this polygon to right here, essentially doing the same thing. And then if we re-pour them, we can see the situation that he's talking about. So here we have a differential pair. It's being routed over ground. You can see the uniform ground ends right here. And then it continues on like nothing happened, but there's no ground plane under that trace anymore. Well, in this case, if we just go back to our differential pair calculation and we just calculate what would happen if we had the ground plane very far away from our trace, but then we use this other width of 9.407 in the calculation without ground, you can see here that the calculated impedance is 98 ohms. So we can see clearly from this simple calculation that there is an impedance mismatch between these two regions. We go from a region of 90 ohms or low impedance into a region of 98.5 ohms or high impedance, and then there's going to be some reflection right there at that interface. Now, how much reflection and whether or not it matters really depends on a few things. Here in this example, we're talking about a lower speed USB interface, and it's then connecting to a cable which also has 90 ohm impedance. So it's a pretty short section that I've drawn that has that 98 ohm impedance. Now, while there may be a measurable effect on signal integrity, is it going to cause the device to cease to function or cause it to fail EMC? Unlikely in my opinion. But for many other interfaces that require much higher channel bandwidth, it could absolutely cause the interface to fail to function. Now, in much lower bandwidth situations, for example, if you're dealing with an analog interface that's being routed over a differential pair, probably not going to matter either. You're typically dealing with, let's say, 10 megahertz or less. And in that case, the input impedance deviation that you see at the interface between those two regions is going to be very small, and there's probably not going to be a signal integrity issue in that case. So once again, this is all about the channel bandwidth, and I've talked about this in other videos. The channel bandwidth is really the important metric that you have to use to understand signal behavior in high-speed digital PCBs. There's another concept that's used to understand whether or not that high impedance region is too long or too big, and that is sometimes called critical length. And I think critical length is BS as a design rule, but it's actually pretty useful as an analysis tool. And that's something I'll be talking about more in upcoming videos. I've also talked about it in a video on the Altium Academy channel. And if you want to watch that video, check out the link in the description. Thanks, XR17992. I always love getting great questions like this. And if you're watching this video right now and you have a great question, feel free to leave it in the comment section. And if it's a great question, it just might end up in one of these videos. Make sure to hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, and I'll see you next time, everybody.